Hello, and welcome to my new video where I'll be discussing the hepatitis A virus. So I'm going to begin by looking at the structure of the virus, and as you can tell, it's made up of several triangles put together in what's known as an icosahedral pattern. Also, the virus does not have an envelope, and therefore it's a naked virus. Since it's a naked virus, it's fairly small, coming in at around 27 nanometers. Looking at its genetic material, it's a single-stranded positive sense RNA virus, and right here on the 5' end, there's a protein called a VPG, which is necessary for replication. The hepatitis virus is part of the Picornavirus family, and the genus is Hepatovirus. So let's begin by looking at the pathophysiology of the hepatitis A virus to gain a better understanding of the disease and how it impacts the body. The pathophysiology of hepatitis A virus starts with some sort of fecal matter. And that's because the hepatitis A virus is transmitted to what's known as the fecal-oral route. What this simply means is an individual gets exposed to some fecal matter that has actual hepatitis A viruses in them. This could be fecal matter on their food, on their hand, or they may come in contact with an individual who has this matter on them. The virus is eventually ingested, and the virus tends to go straight through the stomach and lands into the intestine, where the first part of the pathophysiology begins. Once the virus makes its way to the GI tract, the patient begins to feel GI-related symptoms. These are symptoms such as nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, and even fever. This typically lasts about 2 to 3 weeks before the patient begins to feel better from the GI symptoms. Now, this is also an interesting period because during this time period, the virus is actively replicating and even shedding in the feces. So in many instances, a lot of the viral particles in the intestine will kind of break off, go into through the colon, and eventually get excreted. In other words, during this time, the patient is very, very infectious. So people he lives with, people he comes in contact with, they are all at risk for contracting the hepatitis A virus from him. After it's in the GI tract over the period of 2 to 3 weeks, then the virus eventually makes its way to the liver. This is typically done via the portal tract. And in a similar fashion, you have this viral particles going from the intestine, breaking off, going into the portal vein, and landing eventually into the liver. Once in the liver, it gains access into the cell by the alpha-2 macroglobulin receptor. Once a virus interacts with this receptor, endocytosis occurs, and the virus makes its way into the cell. So looking at a cell here, you can see, and this is a hepatocyte, you can see there's a virus particle here. Once this virus is inside the cell, it releases its RNA to begin transcription. The enzyme that it utilizes is the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. And once this enzyme gets active, it makes several proteins. You eventually have several hepatitis A virus in the cell. Now, they continue to accumulate. Now, in many other instances, viruses tend to kill their cell in what's known as cytotoxicity. They're cytotoxic. That's not the case here. The virus itself does not directly kill the cell. Therefore, it's said to be non-cytotoxic. So what ends up killing the cell, interestingly, is the CD8 cytotoxic T cells, which get activated and eventually kill the cell, leading to necrosis of the hepatocyte. Once you have this necrosis, then the virus particles get released into the bile acid. From the bile acid, the virus particles go into the duodenum, make its way down through the intestine, through the colon, until they're excreted, and eventually move on to another host. So now let's start to take a look at the epidemiology of hepatitis A virus on a worldwide scale. What you will find is the prevalence of hepatitis A virus is much greater in the third world countries. This includes South America, Africa, and all of Asia. In the first world countries, the prevalence is much lower. And this is, United States, Europe, and Australia. So hepatitis A virus is clearly differentiated on whether it's a first world or third world country. Typically, in the first world, the hepatitis A virus is associated with individuals traveling to the third world countries. This is primarily because of issues related to sanitation, regulations with food handling and distribution. So these factors have played a large role in minimizing hepatitis A virus in these first world countries. So for a moment, let's look at epidemiology specifically in the United States. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a graph here, and we're going to look at between the years 2011 to 2018. And over here on the y-axis, we're going to have the incidence per 100,000 people. Overall, the rate of hepatitis A is fairly low, coming in at around less than 0.5. So in 2011 and 2012, you can see it's actually less than 0.5. However, in 2013, there is this uptick right here. This is attributed to a outbreak in multiple states in the United States, but particularly California, of Turkish pomegranates. So it turns out there was several pomegranates imported from Turkey, and they had these hepatitis A virus particles, and that's what led to a localized outbreak. However, soon after, you can see the rate of hepatitis A virus went back to below 0.5 in 2014 and 2015. However, after 2016, you notice that there's this sharp rise. It went from, you know, less than 0.5 per 100,000 in 2015 to greater than 4 per 100,000 in 2018. So what accounts for this? Well, this is largely attributed to many social factors in the United States. The increased homelessness, the increase in IV drug use that's become rampant since then, and also men having sex with men. So in many ways, the incidence of hepatitis A virus is a indicator of the social problems that the United States is dealing with. So now let's look at some of the clinical aspects of the hepatitis A virus, particularly its symptoms and presentations. First thing to know about the hepatitis A virus is that it has a long incubation period, up to 28 days. So typically a patient would have some history of traveling to a third world country about a month ago and suddenly developing these symptoms. Although this is not an official distinction, I like to think of the hepatitis A virus in two stages, stage one and stage two. Stage one of the hepatitis A virus, I think of as from like a GI tract, and that's when the virus is actually in the GI system. And stage two, I think of it as the liver stage, and this is when the virus particles actually go into the liver. Interestingly, a majority of people will only have stage one, and about 40 to 70% of patients will go on to have the stage two symptoms. In stage one, we have those classic GI symptoms that I described earlier: nausea, vomiting, abdominal pain, fever. And these can be experienced for many reasons. So many patients will not think anything of it. If a specific patient is part of that 40 to 70% that moves on to the liver symptoms, they'll get the classic liver type symptoms. And this is going to be your jaundice, your pruritus. They also develop a rash and arthralgia, and that's just due to any type of viral infection. And when you do a clinical examination or imaging, you will note hepatosplenomegaly, so that will be there. Fortunately, hepatitis A virus is not chronic like hepatitis B or hepatitis C, but a minority of patients, around 10%, may experience a relapse. However, all patients who have hepatitis A virus will develop lifelong immunity as long as they have an intact and normal immune system. Now, just because it's not chronic doesn't mean this is completely benign. There are many rare complications to be watched out for and to be aware of. First and foremost, the biggest thing we worry about is fulminant hepatic failure. This occurs in less than 1% of patients, but when it does, it is associated with a very high mortality. In particular, you know, individuals at risk are those with age greater than 50 years old or underlying liver disease. And so these are patients you want to monitor closely. Also, in rare cases, patients can develop autoimmune hepatitis after exposure to hepatitis A. Rarely, someone can have what's known as leukocytoclastic vasculitis. This is a syndrome which is related to an increased IgM antibodies depositing in their vessels. So these patients will get this characteristic rash that develops. So this is something also to watch out for. Cryoglobulinemia, which is another kind of immune complex reaction, can also occur. And many patients will develop glomerulonephritis, which is another immune complex related illness. Myocarditis has been noted, which occurs in a lot of viruses. And of course, optic neuritis, which again occurs due to a lot of viruses, can also occur. Transverse myelitis has been documented as well. So there are a number of investigations that are consistent with hepatitis A virus. Of course, when you see a patient who's jaundiced, one of the first things you can look at is your liver enzymes, ALT and AST. These are typically greater than 1,000, so very, very elevated. So whenever you see this level of enzymes, you should be thinking about hepatitis A virus as part of your differential. Of course, ALT would be greater than AST, and this is consistent whenever you have a liver pathology versus an alcoholic pathology. You will also see an increase in bilirubin, but typically does not go above 10, so it's fairly rare to see it go up that high. ALP, similar story, you will not see it go above 400, so although it's elevated, it's not going to be as elevated as your ALT and AST. At a certain time, your inflammatory markers will be high, and this is understandable if you remember your pathophysiology and the involvement of the cytotoxic CD8 T cells, which causes these necrosis. So you're going to get an elevated ESR, CRP, and other types of inflammatory markers. INR is important to measure. However, it's only increased if the patient has fulminant liver failure. So if this is increased, it's a very poor prognostic sign, and you need to really, really watch that patient carefully. Of course, make sure the patient's not on warfarin. And as a rule of thumb, you should just understand that INR is a good measure of hepatic function in the short term, because AST and ALT could be normal in patients with chronic liver disease. It's also important to be aware of what's known as cholestatic hepatitis. This occurs in less than 5% of patients. And what happens is these patients will have hepatitis A virus, but the labs will be more consistent with some type of biliary disease. So what you'll note in these patients is the bilirubin and ALP is very elevated, whereas the AST and ALT are only modestly elevated. And so, of course, when you see this, you start thinking of some type of biliary disease. You might get ultrasound. You won't find any gallstones, no dilated common bile duct, no evidence of pancreatitis. So when you come across this scenario, it's important to, you know, chase down hepatitis A virus, because that may be what's going on. Now, the ultimate diagnostic test is an IgM antibody against hepatitis A virus. This will diagnose hepatitis A virus for you. Typically, it's going to be elevated for about 3 months, and then after 3 months, you'll notice a reduction in the level. So this test is good for quite a while. With regards to IgG, IgG is pretty much not that helpful. The only time it's used is when they want to do prevalence studies to look at how prevalent it is. But in the clinical setting, IgM hepatitis A virus antibodies is going to be your go-to test to diagnose hepatitis A virus in your patient. So now that you've diagnosed hepatitis A virus in your patient, the next question is, how do you treat it? Treatment for hepatitis A virus is largely supportive. Again, it's a self-limiting condition with no real chronic effects in a majority of your patients. Patients will feel very crummy and they'll be yellow, which can be very scary for them, but you have to explain to them that this is a temporary situation and there's not much you can do. The best advice is just to tell them to avoid hepatotoxic medication, such as Tylenol. Unfortunately, if you encounter one of the few that develop fulminant hepatic failure, then you need to do your best to arrange liver transplant as quickly as you can. Typically, this will mean transferring them to another hospital with the capability, but it should be done quickly because it takes time to find donors and make such arrangements in such a short period of time. And keep in mind, when they get this sick and they become fulminant, these patients can deteriorate very suddenly, so time is of the essence. As you can see, there's not much in the way of treatment for hepatitis A virus, so our primary focus is going to be prevention. Currently, there is an effective hepatitis A virus vaccine available. It's an inactivated virus which requires two doses about 6 to 12 months apart. Now, there are specific indications to give it in the general population. First of all, it's given to all children between the age of 1 to 18, and babies between 6 months to 11 months should receive it if they're traveling. Adults should receive it if they have liver disease. Keep in mind, the efficacy of the vaccine is reduced. However, it's still important to give it to them because these individuals are at the highest risk of fulminant hepatic failure if they contract the virus. Vaccine is also given during periods of outbreaks, such as the Turkish pomegranate outbreak. Also, you want to give it to people who are homeless, IV drug users, men having sex with men, and specific occupations. Now, I typically, the occupation is healthcare workers, like with hepatitis B, but in this case, that's not what's going on. The occupation that they specifically give it for are individuals in research working with the hepatitis A virus. They're at a high risk, so we like to give it to them as well. For travelers, you do want to give it to all travelers who are going to a third world country. They should receive the vaccine if they're less than 40 years old, two doses, 6 to 12 months apart, just like a regular vaccination. However, there are some individuals who should receive the vaccine and the immunoglobulin. And keep in mind that when you give a vaccine and immunoglobulin, it's always in two separate sites, like two separate arms. The people who should get both of these are individuals who are above the age of 40, weakened immune system, any chronic disease, liver disease, or if they don't have enough time to get two shots, then they can get two vaccine doses. They can get that vaccine and immunoglobulin to help them mount the immunity quicker. Now, once they're at their destination, there's several hygiene steps they can take to reduce their risk of exposure. First, they should be sure to wash their hands frequently, avoid tap water and raw foods. So they should be, taking a lot of bottled water and cooked food. They should also be aware that chlorine and iodine does help kill the virus. So that is a good way to kind of clean the things around them if they're concerned. Now, the other issue is to treat someone who's been exposed to hepatitis A virus but doesn't have any symptoms. This is known as post-exposure prophylaxis. Like I described earlier, patients with hepatitis A virus shed the virus in their stool, and so therefore individuals around them are at risk for contracting the virus. So individuals who gets diagnosed with hepatitis A virus, you're going to want to provide post-exposure prophylaxis to anyone who lives with them in their households, any sexual contacts, or anyone that they share needles for IV drug use. Food handlers should also receive post-exposure prophylaxis during outbreaks to reduce the transmission from them. So for individuals who are vaccinated, what kind of post-exposure prophylaxis are you going to do? Well, none. They don't need any treatment. They already have the vaccine and they're well protected. The only exception is individuals with HIV. You should give one dose of immunoglobulins because of course their immune system is weak. Now, how about the unvaccinated? What do we do with them? They should receive a single dose of the vaccine or the immunoglobulin less than 2 weeks of exposure. So that's typically how we treat the unvaccinated population. Now, as we described earlier, we have these patients greater than 40 years old, immune, weakened immune system, chronic disease, and liver disease. How do we treat them? Well, again, just like you'd give them vaccine immunoglobulin before traveling, that's also the same post-exposure prophylaxis. So it works to be about the same. Now, finally, for those who have a contraindication to a vaccination or they're less than 12 months, with them, you would just give immunoglobulins and nothing else as a post-exposure prophylaxis.